podcasting from Chico, California, tucked in between some of Northern California's best freshwater fisheries. This is the Barbless Podcast, a podcast about NorCal fly fishing, guiding, fisheries management, and sustainability. If you have ideas or any questions for the show, leave the guys a voice message on the Barbless Podcast hotline, area code 530-636-2523. Also check out http://podcast.barbless.co, where you can download past episodes and show notes. Be sure to follow them on Instagram at Barbless.co and connect with them on Facebook at www.facebook.com/Barbless.co. Here's your hosts, Chad Alderson and Nick Hanna. Fish on.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to another episode of the Barbless Fly Fishing Podcast. I'm going to host this one. I got Nick Hanna in the room. What's up, Nick?
Hey, how you doing?
Good.
You're going to host it, huh?
Yeah, I'm going to make solo? There was an attempt.
I'll just get out of here.
Well, I said I'm going to try. So we got the start of that, by the way.
We're having fun in the
Yeah, we had a
today.
Little misfire, but we're back on. So, I'm real excited about this one, you guys. There's this dude in the room right now is probably one of the most talented artists you're going to have the pleasure of meeting today. His name is Steve Nielsen from Oroville, right?
Yep.
So if you guys are familiar with his work or not familiar with his work, he does basically full metal replicas of any kind of like trout, steelhead, salmon, butterflies, just the stuff looks real, basically. You know, I've been stalking
walleye.
You.
Yeah, did a walleye. Yeah,
I've been stalking you on Instagram for a couple years, and I'm glad you finally, you know, were able to make it over to Chico and talk to us. We've got a couple pieces on the table right now, and the fish looks real. I mean, it looks like it should be in the water. How long have you been doing this?
I mean, I'd have to go back to far as the welding and stuff, metal finishing, learning to actually work with metal.
Yeah.
I started '85, dating myself. 85, I was in high school. My buddy, he's all, dude, we were both into custom mini trucks back in the mid-90s. All our friends had tilt beds and all that kind of fun stuff. And he's like, yeah, if you want to learn to work on your truck, you got to take metal class. And he was the teacher's pet at the time. He was a couple years ahead of me. So he kind of showed me the way. I started learning and already being very artistic. I've been artistic my whole life, always drawing and things like that. And always looking for different ways. I was kind of really interested in 3D, three-dimensional younger. I always saw people airbrushing in the malls and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. Come over to Chico and see a guy doing t-shirts and stuff going, mm-hmm. Hey, look how it makes that three-dimensional. But that was in the back of my mind. Had no idea how to get into that when I was younger. So it was kind of all these things I'm talking about. I kind of all evolved and merge over the years, but got out of high school, started working on trucks, was top of the class doing welding competitions, all that stuff through high school. And then immediately within a couple of years, I started my own business and started advertising in the truck magazines.
So you're doing fabrication for add-ons, accessories to trucks.
The big thing in the, I would say, early 90s, everybody was putting hydraulics on their trucks. And I was I looked at a vehicle like a canvas. I like the paint. I like to modify the sheet metal. I like to, the stance was always a big thing. You know, if you're going to have a custom vehicle, the stance was always dropping it down. But I hated the ride. The ride quality and stuff was horrible. So somebody said, hey, why don't we put air suspension, down in Southern California. And I kind of knew him through connections, went down to a car show and met the guy. And he's like, yeah, this air suspension, we took him off our RV as a load leveling system. And we hooked it up with performance shocks and the thing rides like a Cadillac and you can adjust it. And all these guys running hydraulics were just destroying vehicles. And I always hated that. I wanted to build an art piece in my own way.
Yeah.
It was a canvas. It was just another outlet for being creative. So I did that for 20 years. I literally from, almost 20, 96, I did it, started advertising.
Yeah.
And in Mini Truck Magazine and Street Trucks Magazine came along. I did over 100 articles. I put together, you know, how to's and submitted articles like editorial and all that kind of stuff. And, Trucking Magazine, Sport Truck, some of these like magazines don't exist anymore because of the internet,
you right, know, right.
come along and it kind of phased them out. But I was always doing custom stuff, and I the more custom, the more challenging, the more I got passionate about it. So then I got pretty much just got kind of like burnt out, you might say. There wasn't nowhere to go.
Were you fishing at this time? Were you,
I grew up and my dad was always fishing and hunting. And so like when I got into the truck stuff, I was working 100, 120 hours a week, and I got burnt out, never seeing the family, never being able to do fun stuff on the side. And so I eventually halfway through the truck scene, mm-hmm. you know, doing it for almost 20 years, I evolved into doing more artwork on the side. I just needed to open up a creative outlet again. Mm-hmm. I started doing like metal work, which I'd never done really towards art. It was all more drawing and painting and stuff. Airbrushed a lot, like just more like motocross helmets and Harleys and stuff is kind of a pre like 93 to 96. Then 96, I just stopped painting and just, it was like all metalwork and fabrication. And that was like what I devoted my time to.
But it sounds like you were doing the things that eventually all manifest on this piece of metal here that we're looking at. You're doing them in kind of silos, and then they start to slowly merge, right?
It evolved. I kept... Wow. In my mind, like if I'm not challenged at what I'm doing, at what I'm working on, what's right in front of me, if I'm not being challenged, the passion's not there. And so I kind of kept taking it, the vehicles, you might say, and building custom frames and doing frame-offs. And one of the last vehicles I ever touched before I sold my shop in 2013 was we had about $120,000 worth of shop time into a truck that I only charged $30,000 to do. And we built the frame from scratch, the control arms, all the suspension, everything on it was completely from scratch. Then we tore every, only thing in the bed that was original was like the outside. So at the time I was building the Eagle, and the Eagle was a commission for the city of Oroville. And that was almost all sponsored, almost 2000 hours. Well, literally all the hours were sponsored, you might say.
Yeah, and this Eagle, Nick, how would you describe this Eagle?
There's nothing like it out there. No,
it's
2,000 hours of metal work.
If you've seen Clash of the Titans, the old one, okay, with there's the owl.
The owl, yeah.
The owl, it's like that. Picture that, but bigger, like 10,000 times more detail and way more badass looking. But it's that kind of craftsmanship and just... The whole thing's chromed out too, right?
It's over 4,000 individual stainless feathers that were sanded and polished.
It's just
welded on individually.
Where does it sit now?
It's actually in the city council where they all have the Oroville City Council meetings at.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
It started out as like, I'll be honest, it started out as a $5,000 do us one of your like lawn art looking projects, you know, something rusted, something that looks like an eagle. Can you do a blue heron too for $5,000, you know, and like just throw it together, kind of a rusted pot metal look, you know, and, or, you know, it's found art look. And I was like, no, like I'm trying to get more into more fine art and I want to refine everything that I do. Like the fish mm-hmm. I was already doing at the time, started doing the fish. Actually, the first couple were 2006 they're actually still on the side of, the KOA camp. Pool house at the Feather Falls Casino over there.
Yeah, I've seen pictures of those.
If you drive through at the Feather Falls KOA, it was like almost completely flat. Didn't look nothing like that fish I just brought you. But that started the whole thing. And then it was just like one after another, it was just people asking me, and like somebody's like, hey, you did the fish for my husband. Can you do me a set of butterflies? Did a set of butterflies. And then now I've done, I lost track, but it's well over 1,000.
Butterflies.
Metal butterflies, custom painted. And
you're booked out for 4 years.
3-4 years for all the custom commissions, and I still in between like some easy, quick stuff just to pay the bills.
Yeah. So you recently did I've been following you for a long time, and you recently did a walleye, right? That was auctioned off at an auction for is it a fundraiser? Is that what it was?
Yeah, the guys up at Fish Futures in Manitoba, Winnipeg, Manitoba.
Yeah.
They put on this annual fundraiser to raise money for Lake Manitoba Lake Winnipeg. And it's a huge walleye fishery and perch and all that kind of stuff. It's supposed to be world class. I guess they're having some health problems with it now with the winters and stuff up there. But they raise hundreds of thousands of dollars every year in their annual event. And they hit me up. It took me 3 years to get around to finally, maybe 3.5 years before I completed it from the time they contacted me, because I was so far backed out.
Oh, geez.
And I put, well, we figured the thing was worth 30 grand when I got done. I did it for a fraction of that because it was another thing. I had never done nothing like that. I started out with the idea of it, and the idea evolved. I had them mail me like a replica of one that they found. It was kind of a cheap replica. Mm-hmm. I mean, I wouldn't say cheap, $700, but it poor quality replica that somebody just threw some paint on. But it gave me the scale, because I'd never seen around here. We're Northern California. There are no walwife.
Right.
But by the time I got done with the thing, it was like insane. I had six, I was working 16 hours a day when I got to the finished part of it, and I was polishing it. And it took me 6 solid weeks working 16 hours a day, 7 days a week to sand it and polish it. I mean, I literally every night I went to bed with my body aching, trying to work it. And
so there's a thing where, if you want to be, a professional in any craft, whatever it is, you need 10,000 hours. How many hours do you think you have into this your game right now?
I would say I surpassed that a long time ago. I mean, yeah, the eagle alone was 2,000 hours, and I mean, I've done thousands of butterflies that were, a few hours each.
Yeah. The butterflies are awesome looking too. I mean, go around catching butterflies.
We've done 70, this will be like 78 or 79 episodes when this airs. So we've maybe got close to 100 hours of recordings. And that kind of shows you how far we have to go now. Dude, insane amount of time.
I've been putting in over 100 hours a week into that butterfly for like the last couple months.
Wow. Oh, it's hard. We talk about this stuff, and I wish we'll have pictures of it, but if you're listening, you're like, all right, where do I check this stuff out? You can find, what's your Instagram handle? Just so that,
Steve Nielsen Art.
Okay.
And the last name's
Nielsen. I think you said
I-E-L.
As long as you're not driving, guys, go check this out.
And follow him. I mean, the stuff's ridiculous, and it's like 50-50 butterflies and fish, I would say, right? Roughly.
Yeah, it
depends kind of like what was in your queue at the time.
It really, butterflies were never my choice. I've had to embrace it, you might say. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm still not like in love with butterflies, but it had to become part of me because once I did a few, it just evolved. And then the challenge of people bringing to me like, hey, can you up that? Yeah. Can you up that?
You've been doing little monarch casings too recently, right?
The chrysalis.
Yeah.
Yeah, actually, I've done quite a few of those. I had a lady come to me that raises them down in Southern California, mm-hmm. monarchs, and she's like, hey, those little chrysalis, the pupa, papa, or whatever they call mm-hmm. the Spanish word for it is. Basically, it's like a
cocoon.
Yeah, that's the word I was looking for. But it looks like a piece of jewelry, the real ones.
Yeah,
they look like a real piece of jade. And they said, can you duplicate it? And I was like,
they're beautiful.
She sent me one that had got infected, with like a disease or something. She said, use it until it dries out, So it took me like probably a month and a half of making them, working on nothing but that, to where I finally felt comfortable with the detail of it, because I have to hand paint them and they're all hand shaped out of solid steel.
I was going
to
ask, so are they hollow in the middle? Are they
solid?
They're solid pieces.
They're solid steel, and there's so much, it's simple, but it's very intricate.
A lot of intricacies in that, and a lot of detail.
I've had a couple opportunities, like the I guess it's coming out this year. I think it's coming out this year, the new Godzilla,
mm-hmm.
but they do a, they contacted me, the costume designers, 2 years ago, and they said, we found you on Etsy. It's Steve Nielsen Art, mm-hmm. also on Etsy. And then they said, we saw these monarch chrysalises or cocoons. Can you do us a couple in the green stage, the jade stage? And then the jade turns clear, and then you see the black with the orange, wings, the butterfly right before it emerges. So there's that two different.
Was that for Mothra?
Yeah.
That's sick.
So they said, send us some, and they said, we can't guarantee it, but we want to show the origin of the girl that started the Monarch Enterprises, I guess it is.
Mm-hmm.
And so she might be wearing it when they show a flashback.
Like on her chain, on a charm or something.
Yeah, as a charm. And then maybe throughout the movie. And then just recently, some filmmakers up in in Washington was doing, they do all the, I guess, the film spots, like commercials for, I can't think of it, Dell. Dell is merged with another company, and they do like a data type of a company. So they're doing some commercial where a guy opens up his hand and has like a huge, like a 2-inch, like I had to make it like a much larger than real, but a 2-inch chrysalis. And then on the other hand, he opens his hands and butterflies just like, and it's something to do with evolving or merging or something with, but so that's supposed to come out anytime too. It's kind of cool.
Interesting.
Kind of fun.
I'm just, you know, I'm looking at this piece that's on the table and I just can't even believe this thing was once a flat sheet of metal. It's insane. Can you talk about the tools that you use to kind of, you know, you're essentially taking a piece of clay almost and just putting it into the shape that's, you know, looks like it's a real fish. Like, what do you, how do you, what's the process to transform a piece of metal, flat piece of metal, into what we're looking at?
It starts at a 16 gauge stainless. I choose stainless. It's a lot harder than, I mean, you could probably Google metal fish.
Yeah.
And there's probably 100 people out there, different guys like pounding on them, trying to make fish and selling them. And they're probably like a fraction of the price of what I would charge. Mm-hmm. However, I mean, that's kind of how I started out too. We all have to start somewhere. I just had that hunger to want to keep getting better and learn the tools and learn the craft and master it. Mm-hmm. So I wanted to refine it. And, really where I start, stainless is, I guess, got to say it's 10 times harder, at least. I don't know.
When you say harder, you mean as a material it's harder?
It's harder to work with.
Okay.
So you got aluminum, which is super soft. Scratch is easy, you know, like a wheel or something on a truck or a vehicle. If it's polished, you could scratch it really easy. And then you got regular steel that it will rust, it will corrode, and it's like a harder, but it's easier to work with steel. It's soft. And then you got stainless. And I'm kind of surpassing a few things in between, but like stainless is got a nickel inside of it, inside the metal, it, which allows it to, I was told by a guy that's another stainless artist that stainless will last like up to 1,000 years in salt water without corroding, you know, unless you contaminate it. Like if you were to get it too hot and open up the pores, you could actually burn the nickel out and then it could rust. So the stainless is why I chose it, even though I'm painting most of them. If it ever chips, it won't like rust underneath the paint and it can be touched up easy. So, and then stainless actually throws off. I started out, this is like more realistic, but I started out doing a lot of grind marks. Kind of, you see a lot of people doing that metal art with grind marks and it gives it that kind of that water reflection look, which is cool too. It just, it's not as refined, I guess, is what I'm trying to, what I've been going towards. I still don't mind doing those. I just charge a lot less and put less color so you can see it. But anyway, the stainless throws off a light. Like it catches, it's harder metal and whatever's in it, it captures, every little scratch mark will capture the light more. So when I used to do the grind marks, that was really a big thing with the stainless, because you would like, you'd see it come right through the paint. And you see that in the butterflies. The ones that are not necessarily realistic, but the ones that are more of a, I call them the fantasy butterflies. I'll put all these kind of a sunburst, if you will, kind of like starting from the middle, kind of going out, grind marks that are in a, like a clean pattern. And when you roll it around, I use candy paints, which is basically iridescent paint. You can see right through it. And you put it, spray it over with the bare grinded metal, and then it's just an added effect. So when people see it in any kind of light, so even in a room, if it was kind of low lit and there was a light behind them, as you walk past it and you see a curve of a painted piece of metal art that has grind marks in it, the light behind you will kind of follow you. It almost looks like it in kind of low light, like in the almost dark, it almost looks like a holographic way, like the grind
marks change as you move across.
And I'm even seeing it in the piece that we're looking at, because, you know, I keep looking at the tail of this fish that you've made. And, you know, if you looked at a bigger fish's tail, that there's those translucent membranes that hold the spines together on the fish. I don't know what they're called. But this thing, I know it's a piece of metal in my head, but I'm looking at it and it looks organic.
You can see through the tail.
Dude, it looks organic. It's crazy. And then the way that the gloss that's on it, it looks wet. So it looks like you just brought it out. So, it, you know, all the environment light that's going on is playing with this.
I kind of like how you have the eye looking down on this one's, and this. See how this one has the eye staring out. So in photos, like as a fisherman, you look at fish on Instagram, you'll see it. If the eye is sticking straight out, that means they bonked it, right? Or it's about to die, or if not,
you
dead.
Mean like it's physically popped out of their head?
No,
more,
no, or? Just where the black part of the eye is looking straight out. If the black part of the eye is looking down, most likely that fish is still alive and they're going to release it.
I did not know that.
I don't know if you knew that or not, but I could see, see the difference in those two. How did you do the scales? Did you put like a screen so over crazy. The top of that and spray it? Is that how that turned out like that?
I always get people trying to tell me the shortcuts and I'm like, shortcuts like calculate into looking cheaper.
and we're talking about there's hatch marks basically where
it looks like
where
diamonds or scales on the metal. Yeah.
That's I was following a guy named Rick Crane, and he started out as a fish biologist, became like a world-renowned fish replica painter using, like, he actually does skin mounts too, but mostly just replicas, like fiberglass. Mm-hmm. And then he got so good, he started judging the competitions around the world, like fish carving paintings and all that kind of, those competitions they do. And then he became where he was doing videos, DVDs on how to do it. And then he only does museum type work, like commission museum work, because he's so well known, like famous for it all around the world. I had another.
That'll be you someday.
So I had it. I had another friend that's up in Washington, and he's like kind of a. He said Rick's my mentor, and he's like he's got some videos. He's like, I'll get the videos and like just kind of, and they're like we're talking 4 hours just on him painting one side of a fish.
Wow.
And so he's all, and he explained to me that he's like you don't use airbrush for everything, because airbrushing is kind of like, you could tell like when a picture like in a magazine of a woman or something, for instance, been too over airbrushed, like Photoshop airbrushed, it looks too fake. He's like, to give it that really natural look of like all the sequences and stuff and all the colors and stuff, you got to use like a powdered paint pigment. And it's almost like the consistency, it's basically the same thing as like blush and makeup, like women would use on their face, and building layers and creating layers. So he explained that to me. And so I got a couple of the guys' videos and I started watching them, and I was trying to, this is a couple of years ago when I did this fish you guys are looking at on the poster here. And he told me, if you want to really get the realism, he's all, you're going to have to like hand paint it with powder. And I was like, powder? I've never, what the heck? So I ordered all this stuff, like about $900 worth of taxidermy type fishing, fish painting supplies. And it was almost like all powders. We're talking like in the top half that you can't even see, because it's like built under layers and layers and layers, is gold, like grounded up gold powder. Like we got bronzes down here in this color you see at the bottom.
See it, yeah.
That's a bronze metal that's been ground to a powder that you put on with like a blush type of application, like people would use on their face. And all the little in between the lines, like in between the scales, color pencil, like watercolor.
Jeez.
So like each line was like each little one I had to hand draw it. And this is kind of like so let me give you like a little insight. So on the video I was watching and trying to learn, I really wanted to take the best metal work and the best fish painting techniques and blend a medium, because I want people to know that it's like actual sculpture. It's not something you could just get mass produced. This is hand built one time, one piece, hundreds of hours. But that's why I leave the head. I always leave the head on the high end ones, especially always leave some bare metal, because I want people to know. And on the high end, the double sided fish, the inside of the mouth completely polished, the tongue, the top of the roof of the mouth, everything is completely polished. So
that's cool.
So when people walk up to it, the paint or the powdered, it's still paint. It's just a powdered form, I guess. The paint just blends right into really to where you can't even see there's a line. It just kind of
like a brush line. Is that what you mean?
Yeah. You can't tell. It all blends. Yeah. So if you were to picture say there was like such a thing as like a chrome fish. Like,
there is.
Well, a steelhead.
We saw a few of them.
But, I mean, just about to ask that, because this steelhead is beautiful. It's got the red, like darker colors, like it's been spawning, and it's beautiful.
Fall colors.
But I was curious if, I don't think I've ever seen you do one that's a
all chrome.
Like a chrome steelhead.
I've been wanting to do it.
That would look sick.
Can I get on your waiting list and just order one for myself? And I don't know if my lady would like it hanging up, but
I'll split it with you and put it on layaway.
Share it.
You have it 1 year. I have it the next year.
I tell people I'm a 3-4 year waiting list on the big one. So if the budget's a problem, you got 3-4 years to save up.
It's rad, man.
But yeah, for sure. I would love to do an all. I mean, there's a lot of ways that I could, my brain, when I start thinking of different ways of doing it, like say an all, a totally chrome steelhead.
This top piece would be identical. It would look the exact same on the back. It would just not have any color for the rest of it down. The scales and the way you have it on the scales is the same, just chrome.
There's another idea though, that would take it to another level. And that's what I'm always thinking.
All right. I'm with you.
A full chrome steelhead.
Yeah.
But engrave every single scale. Whoa. I mean, I don't know. It could be a $30,000 fish when I got done or more because I don't know. I could have 1,000 hours into engraving. But if I engraved every single scale, polished the whole thing, and then went back, clear coated the polished stainless, and then went back and started adding a little bit of color over the scales. Mm-hmm. But like, there's different ways you could do it.
Yeah.
Like,
I'm following you.
So, let me give you a kind of a comparison. If you were a fish replica painter, you would start out with a perfect cast, fiberglass cast of a real fish, right? So you got scales to work with.
Right.
So the trick that really, to get those dark lines, like you see that I used a colored pencil for, I'm using a smooth surface. Sure. So I have to create the illusion that there's a scale there. With them, they have a scale. So what they do is they spray the whole thing. They primer it, obviously. They shoot a black, a lot of times they'll put a gold powder over the top and a silver across the bottom. So a little silver goes up over that lateral line a little bit. Mm-hmm. And then they spray black over the whole thing and they throw kind of like a clear inner coat, they call it. It's just basically clear paint. Paint. It's basically the same consistency as paint, but like no color. Mm-hmm. It protects it a little bit. Let that dry. Then they sand the whole thing off with Scotch-Brite or a double lot, like a, why can't I think?
Steel wool.
There you go. Okay. Like a steel wool, double out steel wool.
Yep.
Just draw a blank. But when you got done, and it's this, that process right there could take you like quite a few days just to get, if it's a big fish, and especially if it's double sided. But then what they do is they take it all down, and when they get done, they call it antiquing. They don't want to really take all the paint past the primer. They want to leave all those, that black, gold, and silver around each scale to give it the depth.
Texture, the depth.
And so then they just created the foreground, and then it's like another, I mean, some of these guys will spend like a couple months painting a fish to create the layers and layers. Mm-hmm. So that's what they get to do, and that's the fun part for them, I mean, to create the antique, because then after that, then they go back and they start hand painting scales.
Okay.
They start layering candy colors like over the top, the different colors, yellows and greens and golds that kind of all blend together to give you the olives and the different tops of the back color. And then the scales alone, I mean, every fish, and depending on what strain and where it comes from and what time of year, it's always going to be obviously different variations. But the scales alone, when they call it tipping. Mm-hmm. That's like a taxidermy term, I guess, when it's called scale tipping. Mm-hmm. They're taking like a little type of like a number 2 paintbrush or even like a makeup applicator for doing like the little lines around the face. And they're taking this powder, like a silver ground up aluminum is basically, I have this stuff. It's a Gold Leaf company, and it's a bottle of powdered ground up aluminum. And that's what that is right there that you're looking at. But then you take some, every time you put the powder down, you got to like put a layer of clear inner coat over it to lock it down. Otherwise you barely breathe on it, blows off.
I was wondering about that. Yeah.
How do you apply that stuff without smearing it all over the place? If it's dry,
it ends up all over the floor. A lot of times actually, what you do is you're brushing it on, and then you're kind of, you just give a little, you know, like blow with your breath, and it blows the excess off, and it just leaves just enough there. And then after you get what you want, then, and that's all around the face too, to create the depth of the face.
Holy smoke,
I think you should be contracted to do a golden trout for the state.
Dude,
that'd be cool.
But big one.
Each scale has anywhere from 3 to 5. I mean, each scale has to be painted 3 to 5 times, like thousands of scales on a fish, right? So each scale has to be painted anywhere from 3 to 5 times to get the depth and the because it's so translucent too. It's like one little layer of silver isn't mm-hmm. going to like cover it enough. But to get that look that you see, and you see some of them are darker than others and brighter than others. And there's other ones like, I'll go back and if you kind of tip that fish in the light, you would actually see some colors of like of pearls. And I got like probably 6 or 7 different colors of pinks and purples, blues. Well, I have actually about 40 colors of different pearls. And there's probably about 6 different pinks, different. There's like probably 5 or 6 purples, lavenders. There's blue purple. There's golds mixed in with pink, golds mixed in with reds. I mean, they all kind of flip flop.
You got to be a craftsman to mold these fish to where they are at and then to then paint them the way you do. Like, I'm starting to think about it more and more. And I'm just who the hell does this?
What's going through my head right now is my jaw is like on the floor. But how do you maintain the level of concentration needed for that long of time in a particular set, you know, sitting for a day? Like if you're cranking for 10 hours, say, you can't at like hour 9 get lazy because there's zero margin for error here.
He listens to our podcast. A lot of podcasts. But
how do you, what do you do? Like what's going on in your head? Like when you sit down and do this, are you just one of those people that can get in the zone and stay in the zone for as long as you
sometimes
want?
Sometimes it takes me a few days to get in a zone. Mm-hmm. Sometimes I have to stop and stare at it for a little bit. And sometimes I have to like have two or three other small. Yeah. I
might come back to it.
During salmon season, like my dad, like, you know, he's a retired salmon guide. Like we'll go every single morning, 7 days a week, you know, usually then like go eat breakfast. And by 10 o'clock, I'm back at the house, you know, cleaning the fish and then working
again. Is this why when you pause on a project, is this why you have multiple projects going?
Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah. So I have I have some in-betweens, I call them. Mm-hmm. And it's the ones that pay the bills. The big projects, the mm-hmm. ones that are really awesome, mm-hmm. I almost never stop when I max the budget out. A lot of times I will put in an extra month, 2-3 months into a big project. And it's not because I just like love the customer. I mean,
it's your brand, and I think it's your obsession also.
It's an obsession that I want to be better. Mm-hmm. And I figure if the guy's paying me $4,000, for instance, to do a certain level, mm-hmm. and I'm to a level that I hadn't actually done on that particular fish, but the ideas in my head are thinking, well, this, and this would be like the ultimate. Like, that's what I would really love to do. I'll just say, I'm not stopping. I'm going to keep going and until I complete the vision in my head. And once it's complete, I feel like, okay, anybody else that wants that, that's the next, this is the price. I know how much work is involved in that particular piece.
Okay.
And that's how I've evolved everything I've done. And kind of to step back just a little bit when we were talking about the truck stuff.
Yeah.
I sold that shop in 2013 to commit myself 100% to just doing the art. Like 2013. Yeah. So I've been self-employed doing stuff that I love doing since 1996. And then in 2013, I sold the business, full-blown machine shop, custom shop, had frame tables, building frames from scratch, suspensions from, I sold parts all over the world, like for almost 20 years, like Australia was huge. So that, I guess I created a pretty good brand. Like it was always like had the artist creative touch to everything I did, but those people followed me. But when I sold that, a lot of them like couldn't understand, like, why would you just abandon that, you know, the industry, you know, cause to them it's like, you know, it's a lifestyle. Mm-hmm. I'm like, I just wanted to keep learning. I wanted to keep perfecting. Pushing. And I couldn't really do what I wanted to do with the art, the creative stuff, mm-hmm. and put in 80 to 100 hours a week into that business and then do the art. Like the Eagle, I worked on it for 4 years part-time, around another 100 plus hours I put into other businesses. And then when I sold the business, it took me 6 months working day and night, 7 days a week to finish the Eagle so I could deliver it finally. So 4.5 years, 2,000 hours calculated, a little over 2,000. But so fast forward, like, you know, it took me a couple years to downsize. I downsized everything because I wanted to be able to like put every single thing I had, every envision that I had of ideas I had. I didn't want to limit myself. So I just sold the big house I had, got rid of all the payments. Only car I have, one car is like my wife, I'd work from home. So she drives it to work.
Yeah.
And
you're all in.
Yeah, all in, 100%. Got my overhead had to go super low. So any other artist that wanted think that, you know, like, oh, it's just like you've always had it easy. Like I literally just went without like everything else just to focus on.
Have you ever on doing it. Thought about bringing in some like interns or kids to help you with some of the easy base work and to kind of like open up your business a little bit more?
I did that so many times with the custom truck world, and everybody that I taught what I knew to relieve myself of like so I could focus on other things.
Yeah.
Every one of them thought like, oh, this is easy. And then they went out, tried to steal all the customers and say, oh yeah, I learned everything from him. And I already know, I could tell you right now, there's other artists that I've been hit up multiple times over the last few years. And they're like, I'd pay anything to come down and just work for free to learn what you learn. And they're already trying to copy what I'm doing now. Sure. So if I brought them in to help me, really it's helping them put myself, you know,
I'm thinking of like even younger kids, you know, they learn how to weld,
like 8 to 12 years old,
TIG welders. Is that what you call it?
Yeah,
right?
TIG, yeah.
I mean, I want to learn all this stuff, you know, I haven't done it yet, but, just for my own boats and things to work on, you know, I think it'd be super cool to real quick question. So the one piece that we're looking at is just it's a half. It's right.
It's one half,
half of it. And then the picture is whole. Right, it's a whole
full body. Yeah.
So did you just take those two pieces and weld them together and buff it out? How did you do that?
Well, there's kind of a couple things. Like the one sided, you might notice that there's no curve to the real body, like a fish. You know, you might when you're holding it, it has a kind of an arc to the body.
Right.
So that's the quicker way to do it. If I laid that flat and didn't have the fins welded on the bottom.
Mm-hmm.
It's not perfectly symmetrical. I mean, there's, you know, because I'm just shaping it out of flat. So however it ends up is however it ends up.
Right.
And I added, there's a little bit more. Like over the years, I've done over 100 of those trout. And I designed them in the computer, taking all my knowledge from designing truck parts, suspension parts.
And you have a laser cutter that cuts it out?
I have everything laser cut.
Yep.
I've probably since 2003, I've had everything laser cut. Mm-hmm. Before then, I actually had about $100,000 plasma cutter that was CNC. But it just wasn't as clean. So I went to laser about 2003, and instead of buying a $500,000 machine, I just source it out. There's actually a guy in Chico that I have does it out by the airport for me.
Proto-Pro.
Yeah. Actually, that's NorCal Laser out there.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Eric at NorCal
Laser. Oh, yeah.
So they put the cookie cutter pieces out for you, and then you take them from there.
I play with it in a computer. I design it all out flat, and then I just tell them what size I want it. And then like I'll have maybe a half dozen of different sizes cut. Mm-hmm. When I burn through those, I learn something. And then I make little measurements like on paper, like the next one should be a little bit
like
taller.
Like a pattern, here, basically.
A pattern. Yeah. And then I go back to the computer and I make those adjustments. And like just like suspension parts back then, I had like say an S10 truck. I built a bolt-on air suspension system for it.
Nice.
And over like 20 years, I probably changed that design like well over 200 times. Almost like every time I had laser cut parts to do it, I would get feedback. I'd do the installs. Like every time I got feedback, I would actually make those changes before I had more parts cut. And every time somebody copied me, I'd make it more complicated just so it
sounds like software development.
So that's my thing. I like complicated because the more complicated and the harder it is, the less likely that people don't even try to copy the fish anymore. Like when I was doing them simple and cheap, everybody wanted to know what I was doing, how I was doing it. And I was like usually an open book. I like to help other people and teach other people. I don't want to give them every one of my secrets. I'll tell them what I use and the equipment that I use and like go figure it out, you know. And
well, what you're talking about too, like when I look at it, you don't want to say inconsistency because that's not what it is. I mean, that's what you're looking at, a piece of metal that should be like perfect, right? That's it's shaped right or shaped. Mm-hmm. But when I'm looking at this, I can look at the belly and I'm like, dude, that looks like a fish's stomach.
It looks organic. Know?
Like it's,
they're not symmetrical.
And then the gill plate and the proportion of the head to the body, just, all of it really is just spot on, man. It's awesome.
Yeah, really like cool. The scale, when you said scale like 3 or 4 times, and the folks that do the cast ones, you know, they have a huge advantage because the scale is kind of already defined.
It's already there,
but if you know you're building scale from scratch, it's real tough.
Scales like
scale, like the size, the proportion,
the scale
size,
of the fish,
you know.
Yeah, it makes me think about we were talking about the scales and the intricacy of them. Like when you hook a fish and then it comes off and you bring back your fly or your hook and it's got a little, like a little scale on there. You're like, oh man, that was a fish, you know, for sure. Yeah, I got a scale on there, you know? And then it's funny. That's steelhead fishing or trout fishing. Then you go to like something like striper and you're stripping streamers and you come and you get something and then fly comes back and you got this silver dollar scale on there. You're like, oh, that was a good one.
As soon as you start talking, I started thinking the last time I was striper fishing and reeled in and like had some big old huge silver scales on the hook. something interesting is like, look at this. This was like probably my best in the end of 2015 that I did. This trout you're looking at on the poster here was for Galvan Reels.
Galvan Reels.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. Actually,
great family, great reel company.
Marcus down there, he invited me to come down. I told him I'd deliver it to him because they were giving me a bunch of reels for like doing all the extra work I did to this thing. And I'd never trout or never fly fish before that. That was like, I wanted to, but I've never fly fished. It was just I didn't know anybody that ever did it around here. So, He had me go down there, and him and his son took me way up in the hills in Sonoma. Like we're talking like a 30-minute drive down like a back log trail to this, like ended up in this river. This like basically a big creek. And it was like, we're talking deep, deep, deep into the woods. And, we had to hop some rocks. We're talking like 3-4 foot gaps. We're like in the water's like 3 feet deep.
Rock hopping. Under. I love that. That's my style of awesome, fishing.
Yeah. And he's like, okay. He's like, I've been going here since I was a kid. My dad taught me how to trout fish here. And his kid at the time, I think his kid was like 8 years old and his kid was like, had been doing it since he was probably
like a gazelle.
Like oh that. Yeah. Yeah. He was like, my brother lives here in Chico. He's big. He ties flies and everything too, but he's still not, he knows about as much as I do, I guess. You know, we both kind of got interested a couple years ago at the same time. And so I had him go down with me. And so the son takes my brother downstream and I go with Marcus and basically our personal guides and using all their stuff, you know. And in fact, I think they had like a $400 or $500 rod that like snapped in half. Like it was like going through the trees and he's like dipped down and it caught a branch and snapped. He's like, no big deal. They'll send me another one. Like they get it. Like they just trade out stuff like all the time. Sure. But that was like my only major fly fishing for trout type thing other than me and my brother just playing around. I have to go out with you, I guess, one of these days and like really do it like locally.
I was going to say, maybe you guys can do some trade. Nick will do like 10,000 guide days.
Yeah, we could do something.
You we were talking about when you hit a roadblock with the stuff you're working on and like the tactics you use to get out of that headspace, because there's a lot of people that listen that have jobs that are creative, I'm sure, and or you know, maybe it's a client that's giving you a hard time and you're just frustrated. Like how do you push past those times when you're stuck in the mud?
A lot of times when I'm creating something that I had never done before, which is almost every time, because even a trout, I'll try to reinvent it. Not because I don't want it to be easy. I want it to be hard because then I can learn something new that I might be able to apply to the next one. And let's just go with the walleye. I've never done a walleye. I've never seen a walleye. So the walleye was like, I think that was like 700 and I forget. It was like between 700-800 hours into the walleye and it was no paint, just polished stainless. Mm-hmm. I had no idea how to do it and I wanted to put a curve in the body. So I actually, this one was hand built, like hand hammered, like using different mallets and hammers in a sandbag and different dies.
Does it look like that? It looked kind of like that, right?
Isn't started the out curve? Looking like
the
that.
The curve though.
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah.
You're talking about the tail at the bottom where it kind of.
The walleye kind of had a bow to it, like as if you were holding it kind of flat and then tip sideways in the bowed in the middle.
Yep.
So that's how I want them all to look that way, but it takes some crazy equipment to be able to like shrink the sides and then stretch the metal in order to create the curve in the metal. Once you take and bend it around to a fish, it's still going to be flat, you know, like as far as looking.
Yeah. Oh,
looking,
so you literally have to extrude certain parts of the metal to make that curve happen.
So when you're folding, that makes sense. When you're shaping the top and the bottom to create the curve, that's actually relatively easy. Anybody could probably get to that point. Then it comes to the next level. So I basically financed a little over a $6,000 power hammer. It's like pneumatic power hammer. It's like probably the most heavy duty air hammer I've ever found. And
looks like a little mini jackhammer almost.
It's pretty much upside down. It's like the guy that designs it's up in like Nevada City or just outside Nevada City. He's been doing it for 30 years and he's world renowned. He worked for Boeing and did all kinds of stuff for like Harrah's, like built custom cars up there in Nevada for years. So he actually brought me up with that fish before it was painted, the one on the poster here.
Mm-hmm.
And he saw that on Facebook and I said, I want to put a curve in my next fish. And I go, all this work, but it doesn't look realistic enough to me. I want to put a curve and I want it to look natural. And I'm like, I have no idea like how to do this with hand tools, you know, like hand hammering. He's like, I can't believe you put that much time into something doing it by hand.
Yeah.
And like I said, that one, the metal work of that had over 400 hours. The paint was about 80 something. But that particular one, I brought it up there to him when it was bare metal ready to be painted, and he got to look at it, and he's like, dude, he's like, you're gonna blow your shoulder out, your arms out. He's like, this metal work, especially stainless, because a lot of these guys that are using aluminum when they're building car stuff, mm-hmm. when they're doing like full bodies, and you see these guys like on these TV shows doing stuff, they're using like either aluminum or like thin, very thin metal.
Way more pliable,
and it's like stainless times 10 as far as how hard it, like you hit, like say you hit like regular thin sheet metal that you'd build a hot rod, like, you know, a hood or something out of, you hit that once with like a mallet or something and it puts a pretty good dent. If you hit it the same exact hardness with a stainless, it wouldn't even probably put a dent in it. Like, so I had to go to power because I was just wearing my shoulders that were aching all the time. Literally felt like I was at a gym, you know, like.
I can't even imagine.
Yeah.
I'm looking at your hands and I was expecting to see some just battered, like, guide hands, you know. But they're actually not too bad. I do see some cuts.
I see some scars. I got scars everywhere. But I started wearing gloves because that stainless will just rip you apart.
Right.
It's just so stout. So I got the power hammer, right? And I got the power hammer right before I started the walleye. And the walleye was 16-gauge stainless. I wanted it 16-gauge, which is really relatively thick for stainless to be shaping it. A lot of guys, if they were going to use stainless, would probably go no thicker than stainless. I mean, I'm sorry, 18-gauge. So that's probably all foreign if you're not familiar with different thicknesses. But to give you an idea, most cars, the metal on a car would be probably half the thickness of 18-gauge.
Compare it to like a coin, like a penny.
Okay, 16.
And stack a penny if you need to.
A nickel is probably pretty equivalent to 16-gauge.
Okay.
And then stainless is like super, it's so hard. So here's another thing. It's already hard to work with, right? So then I had bought the power hammers to be able to like really get in there and shape it good. So then I learned the definition of called work hardening. I've always heard about it, but never experienced it because I never took it to that level. And the walleye had that curve in it where I was really stretching and shrinking to get the curves. Mm-hmm. And with any kind of metal, the more you pound on it and the more you try to shape it, the harder it gets.
It's like swords back in medieval times.
Yeah.
So they have to, there's a process called annealing. And basically if you're working with any kind of metal and you want to keep working on it, once it gets hard, it won't move anymore. It like literally will get brittle to where it will start cracking if you don't soften it. So you have to heat it up. So that stainless on that, as I built two different sides, as I was building it, I had to, even though I was using the power hammer to kind of help me get it there. So I wasn't using like my shoulder. I was more like, I mean, my wrists are still taking a beating because you're trying to hold it and it's like getting pounded by like, you know, two little anvils like with the power. So you almost need to wear like wrist, like guards or something to keep your wrist
from the bowling wrist things.
Yeah. Cause like I was, the smaller the piece to hold on to, the worse it is on your hands. Cause you're trying to hold it and it's like trying to jerk, you know, and bend this like heavy metal. But I had to heat it up. Like I had to go get a pretty big torch and then start heating up the metal to where it was almost so hot I couldn't hold on to it. Then wearing some pretty thick gloves, like welding gloves, to hold the metal and then go right to the hammer and then start shaping it again. As soon as it would cool down and I'd hammer a little bit and it softened it up enough with the heat to where it really moved. But then I go back to the heat again. So I was like, man, the process was just a nightmare. talking like weeks and weeks and weeks and weeks, just working on just getting the curve right. In the working on it like 8 hours a day, sometimes like I'd have to put it down and go work on something small because my arms just couldn't hold it anymore.
God.
How did you? You
I'm
didn't
sweating,
ship,
dude. I'm sweating.
You didn't ship that walleye out, did you? Or did you drive? Did you drive it out there? Did you ship it out there?
Oh, I shipped it.
Shipped it.
I would have threw it in an armored car, man.
How much did they auction that off for?
It ended up going for $10,000. Like I said, I had about at least $30,000. I figured worth the work into it.
Jeez.
What's the biggest piece you've sold?
I was commissioned to do a, in the last, I would say since I've been full time, everything I do also is commissioned, almost everything. I almost never build something, then try to sell it.
Mm-hmm.
I tell people I just don't have time. They give me ideas. Like every single day I get people on social media, like, why don't you do this? Why don't you do that? I'm like, I'd love to do one. I've had it in the back of my mind for years, but I just don't have time. And they're like, why not? I'm like, 'cause everything I do is there's somebody waiting 3-4 years to pay me to do something. So like, I just go down the list, who's the next. And then that it's kind of limited to what I could work on. Right. Because I'm just doing what's on the list. But, I kind of lost track. What was the question?
What was the bigger item that you,
the bigger item. Okay. Yeah. So
most expensive.
This is really cool. This is probably about a $70,000 piece. Mm-hmm. Obviously I didn't get that, 'cause like I way underbid it. I still bid it double what I thought it was going to take me, and it took me about 7 times longer. But I had a guy get a hold of me from Boston, and they were a designer, and they were working with this hotel chain called Godfrey Hotels.
Mm-hmm.
And these guys were like high end like designers of like, you know, they I guess they partnered with like the hotel to do these like really fancy, elaborate bar and restaurants. We're talking high end stuff. And so inside the Godfrey Hotel in Boston, there's this bar they were working on called the Ruka, and it's a rescue bar. It's a Peruvian style food with Japanese. Every square inch of the thing is artistic. I'll have to send you guys pictures of what this, just the inside looks like. The roof, I mean, they commissioned a guy to cut down, like bring these huge slabs of these trees, and they made tables, and the bar is full length of trees, and like the in between the tables, they took the roots of these gigantic, you know, 100+ year old trees, and they cut the roots about 6 inches thick. They sand them and polish them so you can kind of see through them.
Oh, that's cool.
I mean, they spent like, you know, probably a million plus on decorating this thing.
That build out. Yeah.
So they get a hold of me and they're like, we got every single thing thought out. We got all these a collective of all these different styles of art. And we got this one thing. We really want to get this one thing right. And they got about this 20-foot wall of the bar. It's the center of the restaurant. And it's this big old beautiful looking bar, the big old like the wood, you know, for the, and it got this cool looking backdrop of like something they put on the wall that's 3D looking. They said we want something Peruvian, like Incan Empire gold. And I'm like, all right, I've never done that, but like a mentor told me years ago when I got into the truck business in 96, he said, never say no. Is if the opportunity is huge,
fake it till you make it.
He's like, just say yes and figure it out. And something in the back of my head has told me a million times, like that eagle, no idea how I'm going to do a 3D eagle.
Mm-hmm.
I said yes, and I figured it out. And after I did the eagle, I had like so much confidence that no matter how hard it seemed, I could figure it out. I figured like I could figure anything out. So
damn.
I see it in my head, Inca. What you did. Yep. So I've seen that. Yeah. It's freaking bitching.
Yeah. He sent me this little tiny pixelized picture of a Inca. I guess it's like, I thought it was a sun god, but it's
that's
like,
what it looks.
It looks like
looks
an
like.
Octopus arms, and it's called I think it's like actually a sea god,
mm-hmm.
and it's like this head, like Inca looking mask thing, and it was solid gold. The one that they found, they recovered somewhere in Argentina or something, like wherever Inca Empire was. But they, it was like 19 inches, and they sent me this little picture they found like searching the internet of it, and they said, can you replicate that? And I was like, probably, you know, I can get it close. I'm sure I could, you know. I mean, they're using like sticks and rocks and whatever, you know, back in 16th century. I mean, I'm sure I could probably figure it out, you know, and get it at least, you know, where it looks pretty cool. And they said, well, here's the thing. We need it like 8 feet. We need it to fill that space because mm-hmm. it's like the bar had about a 20-foot wall behind it. you know, and like all the liquor stacked for layers. Right. And so, then right. they got the wall, about a 20-foot wall, and we're going to put spotlights on it, and it's going to be the showpiece. When you walk into the restaurant, it's the first thing that people will see. So it's got to look like gold. So that ended up taking me, I can't remember. It was like almost 1,000+ hours or something like that. It was ridiculous. And I started out thinking it was going to only take me 2 months, maybe 3 tops. So I charged them for 2 months and end up working 7 months on it. And the hours I put in were like 16+ hours. So, you know, when I work
per day.
Yeah, per day. Yeah. I mean, like when I'm sanding, I can get in it. You guys, I don't want to bore you, but
no, you're not. I'm just.
Yeah.
I can't believe you can sustain a 16-hour day schedule for 7 months straight. That's incredible.
I did almost 20 years with the truck stuff. My wife would always tell me, she's like, she'd tell people when we're approaching 30 years, I think next year. But, she said like when we were at 20 years, people would be like, "Hey, how's it going? How you guys been up to? What you guys been up to?" Like I hardly ever see him. He's always at the shop. And the joke was always like, you know, for the last 20 years, I've seen him maybe 4 of them, and that was pretty true. And that's kind of like it weighed a big decision on me getting out of that whole industry and doing the stuff. Because now that I work from home,
yeah,
I could put in 16 hours, but like every single night for like the last 2 months, I've been going to bed at like 2-3 in the morning. I'll usually call it quits like right around midnight, one at night, but or one in the morning. But then like it takes me a couple hours to unwind and like watch some stuff on DVR or something. But
what so how many hours a day do you sleep?
I try to get at least 6 if I can. Okay. My eyes are burning right now.
Makes me think of how many yerba mates do you drink?
I know. I mean, I feel extra special to even have you on the show, given how little time you have, free time. So I appreciate you coming in.
I pretty much just. Whenever there's something like, you know, if I go fishing or something, I usually just like to figure that's my day off recharge. Or something. It's a recharge. And then like, I only put in a few hours, like in the evening, just try to get to a next step or set. I'll do some research that I need to do on like a project I'm working on.
Yeah. There's a documentary called Hero Dreams of Sushi. Have you seen it on Netflix?
I don't think I've seen that.
So this guy, you remind me of this guy because he's basically, in Japan, he's got a little like a 8-seat sushi restaurant, but this dude's like fanatical about his craft, and I think you would dig it, and I think you would there would be a lot of stuff that you could relate to that he talks about, because the things you've said and the way that you approach your work is very similar. You should check it out sometime.
What's it called again?
Hero Dreams of Sushi, HIRO.
Yeah, I'll look it up.
It's very good. And I think anybody listening, if you guys haven't seen it, you should go watch it. It's just insane. The work you do is just kills me. It's amazing.
That Inca we were talking about, when I got to the paint part of it, I think I had like 3 months into the metalwork. I didn't have any power hammers. Everything was by hand. So I actually, out of the money that the guy sent me, to get like the deposit, I went out and spent like $3,000 of it just to get the biggest bead roller I could possibly get, which is like something you could put different dyes in and create definitions, like basically your lines and all that.
That's
kind of
how
stuff.
You do the tail and stuff.
That's kind of how I start out with the bottom of the gill plate, how it has the little, with the flex there. I don't know what those things are called. I forget.
The maxilla and the lines.
Yeah. The little lines. I used to hand cut those in, and that's another reason why I like 16 gauge. I can cut in different definitions into it and without burning through the metal. But like I could take a bead roller that has a step, like a 16-inch like or 16th of an inch step, and it like steps the metal down, so I could run it through there and it just kind of drops it down a little bit, and then I can go back and define it with like some like sanding discs that are like a little small like 1-inch like sanding drum disc that are flat. But the fins, I used to do them like that way. Now I actually take the thinnest, like 32nd, like really, really thin, like half the thickness of like, say, my thickness of a dime or thinner. And when it's still flat, I'll cut in those lines with like a die grinder. And once I get in the lines all cut in there, like all these lines of the fins and stuff that make it look all realistic, then like I'll go back and I'll actually start using surface polishers that like won't bring it to a perfect polish, but it like smooths it out quite a bit. And what it does is it takes off that hard cut edge and gives it kind of that blended rounded edge. So then you get that realistic look. Like you can kind of see the difference of these fins that just have like lines cut in them versus maybe what those fins look like. I was even actually looking at that front bottom fin there compared to that one and how I've changed it just in 2 years.
But it looks freaking real. I mean, it looks like identical to what the fish. I keep thinking it's transparent, but it's
not. We keep saying it looks real over and over and over, but it's like, I wish you guys were here to see this thing. It's insane.
Fucking sweet.
I just like, how can I make it better? You know, like I know the average person that like doesn't see that kind of stuff all the time.
Yeah.
It's just like, that's insane. Like, how could you put that many hours into something?
But. So where do you want to take it next? Like what's next? Where do you want to go with this craft?
Everything I do fish wise, I want to add more. My whole like mantra is like bringing metal to life. That's like, that's always been my thing. It's like been back in my head, like since I was a little kid, like everything I do, I want it to like look realistic, whether I paint it or I draw it, whether I create it out of metal. You know, later in life when I started learning how to work with metal tools and I'm like doing the car stuff, I'm like, hey, I could apply that to some artwork. You know, how could I make it look more realistic, you know, more lifelike?
Mm-hmm.
And so to me, like that's the challenge, is like every little nook and cranny, like how can I create it? And the paint to me is like just the icing on the cake. Is kind of like you have to create the, you know, the foundation, and the foundation is the metalwork. So the metalwork has to be like what it's really going to look like. Just like people buying a cast fish, right? You know, if they were buying a cheap one that was like slapped together and the scales were all sloppy, or maybe the scales weren't even on it, it would probably look like a mess. And the in result, it wouldn't look as realistic. So to me, it's like, I really have this idea in the back of my head. I wanted to do it on the walleye, but I was donating so many extra hours to that deal already. And I mean, like I said, it only went for 10 grand. I had like 30 grand probably worth of time into it. I wanted to scale the whole thing. And the only way to do it, to make it look realistic, was to like people were like, yeah, just put a fish, like a stretch out some fish netting type stuff and put on it, you know, like the spongies, those crunchies that they use for like women, like in the showers.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of guys, like fish guys, use those on lures. They cut them open and they stretch them out and they put them over
the exfoliators.
Yeah. And then they like, they stretch them out, however, whatever design they want. And then they like, well, maybe put a dark color down. Then they put that down and they spray a light color over it. And it leaves the dark outline of that plastic.
Yeah, dude, there's at least like 20 fly tires that just had a little light bulb moment going for them when you said that.
And you could do that, and it's cool for doing basic stuff that you're not trying to get high dollar for, and I know some people that do some really nice woodwork, like carvings that look real. I've followed them on Instagram for a long time. There's this guy named Mike, I can't think of his handle, but I would give him a shout out if I could think of his whole name, but his name's Mike, and he does these wood carvings of all these different kinds of trout and salmon and everything, and they look absolutely beautiful. And that's his style, is like he stretches out that netting of whatever he uses, and he puts down a like probably a different color that would like stand out once he puts the other colors over it. And I'm assuming he probably has an adhesive he sprays on it maybe to hold it tight.
Mm-hmm.
Then he does the whole thing, and when he pulls up the netting, you got this outline of like kind of a diamond shape that looks like a scale. To me, that's cool looking, but to me, it's not to the level I'd like to take. I like the more natural, realistic look, you know, and you could obviously, that's not realistic. This was an experiment, and I think that looks more realistic because it was hand painted.
Was this piece on the poster, was that what you would say is that your high water mark right now, your best work that you've done so far in your career?
Yeah, that far as the trout go.
As far as
the trout go, because that's the only real double-sided that I've put that many hours into painting and doing the whole, but I feel like that's like should be like my bottom line stuff. I honestly like, it's been 2 years since I went back and had the opportunity to do anything like a double-sided with a lot of detail. I have this guy, he's already, I'll just throw it out there, guy, I ain't gonna name names, but he's already paid me $8,000 as a deposit to do the best I could possibly do. And I told him if he gave me at least that I would just take it to like the best level. And I said, you're going to be on a list for 2-3 years, possibly. It's been already like a couple of years. And I said, when I can finally get to it, I'm going to take all the experiences I have now and apply it.
I'm going to compound it.
And that's what usually happens to the guys that get on the waiting list, and we can come up with a price range and an idea that when I finally get to it, like my skill level and on my ideas and have compounded throughout all the projects of all those years. Right. So they're getting like double the value. Right. And this guy that paid like $8,000 so far, I'm probably not going to charge him anymore because we just kind of left it at that. I just said, I mean, I told him, I said, like, I could do, he's like, I don't care if you don't put the, you don't even have to paint scales on it. I just want the color kind of like this other one. I didn't really paint the scales. I just kind of gave it the illusion that there was some scales by touching it a few times and putting some spots with pearls in it. Like if you flip it around, like in the light, in that pink, you can kind of see some different, you can kind of, you can kind of see some like variations in the sun. It really pops. But
have you ever been asked to do like a Dorado or a sailfish? Or
I haven't yet.
The mahi-mahi, you know, mahi-mahi. You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, yeah. Yeah,
because they had beautiful colors.
Yeah. Right out of the water, they're ridiculous.
I had a guy get a hold of me. It was a referral from another artist and a guy out of Canada I know that's like pretty well known for drawing and everything. And somebody reached out to him to do some kind of some artwork for like a big thing, I guess. He has the largest sailfish
taxidermy,
this guy puts on these tournaments every year.
Gotcha.
He said these guys will spend like several million dollars for boats just for their boats so they can go out once or twice a year to catch a fish they can't keep. He said that these guys will show up in these yacht type fish.
Rich people problems.
Yeah And so he wanted me to create something last year, and I just said, you know, the waiting list is too long. And I said that if I were to take on something of that intricate, that detail, I mean, we're talking a ton of money for one thing. And he was down in I think Puerto Rico was where it got hit really hard, right? He said he lost everything. They had like multiple businesses, homes, and him and his dad and his family. He said it I think it was 6 months after Puerto Rico got demolished. So he was trying to put together the tournament. It was the world's largest tournament, and I was supposed to do that, and I probably still could go back and get a hold of him if I wanted to, but just I just don't have the time, you know.
I'm thinking about the detail, the butterflies that you do, and the fish, and it's basically putting the two together. That mahi mahi, like that blue and yellow and green, you know.
The candies. Really.
How much would you charge me for a Mark IV Iron Man suit?
I would probably have to. You know what I tell people when they want something that I've never done that's that elaborate? Like, just start sending me as much as you can afford, like every month, or like in segments, and I'll work on it. I'll work on it until that installment's maxed out. And when we feel that, like, you know, I've maxed it out, and you kind of see the proof, then send me another chunk, you know. And
it's almost what you should do for the Iron Man suit is just send it to me in pieces. It's like going to be a reverse ransom. So I'll get a finger first, and then the hand, and then the forearm, and I assemble it.
That would be cool.
What else, Nick?
No, it's awesome, man. Thanks. Everybody that's listening, you can go to our Instagram, and our stories will have some pictures of this, but you can obviously go check out your handle again?
On Instagram, it's Steve Nielsen Art.
Check it out. It's pretty awesome.
You're on Etsy. That's where your store is. There's stuff you can buy today on there, right? That's for sale?
Everything on Etsy is pretty much like I have it under the description. Mm-hmm. It's all prior. It's listed of prior customer's work. And it's basically like built to order.
Okay, got it.
And a lot of the high-end stuff, I almost want to take it off, but I use it as reference.
Sure.
Because I don't want people to buy it off of Etsy and then turn around and be like, can I get it next week?
Yeah, and it also kind of sets an expectation in their mind on what a price might be for a custom.
Yeah, and that's kind of why I leave it. I created Etsy not to sell off of, which I still sell stuff off of occasionally, but strictly when people I've never talked to before, they've never really followed me, they just like a referral, and they come to me and they're like, hey, I got an idea like for a trout, you know, like how much would it cost me?
Yeah.
Like how much is your trout? And I'm like, well, shoot, I've done like hundreds of them, and I've done them at different levels. And I tell people, like, you know, if I were to tell you right now, like you want a 24, 25 inch trout, like that one right there is 25 inch. And I'd say, well, it starts at 500, goes up to 1,000, and then 1,500, then 2,000. And then from that level right there, that's about $2,000 worth of work. From that level right there that you're looking at to 2,500, I would take and build the whole back half of the head and the inside of the mouth.
Okay.
And I would add that for 2,500. You get that same fish with a full 3D looking head.
Yeah.
So it would look like a complete fish. It would look like this, but without the back half of the body. And then after that, it goes crazy because you can't, going back to the original question you asked about the one-sided and the double-sided and how they fit together, they don't really fit together because of the width of a realistic fish. So like you can look at that and it's like, okay, it's the same width kind of all the way down, right? Because it's one-sided.
Yeah.
A realistic fish would be a lot thicker in the middle. That fin wouldn't even be in the right place if it was a realistic looking fish.
Right.
So if I'm to create a realistic fish, I got to build it without any of the fins pre on it. And I got to build it like, and basically fill those pieces in if I'm using these pre-cut pieces, or sometimes if it's like, I'm going to do a 3D fish, I'll just like hand cut the whole thing. Takes a lot of time rather than using a pre-laser cut piece. But if I'm building something of that elaborate, which we're talking like 10, 15 grand for something of that level of double-sided, this right here, easily 15 grand worth of work. But I want to like take it to
on the poster.
I wanted the on the poster.
Yeah.
I want to double the amount of work and detail and the lifelikeness in the next one. And so this guy that paid 8 grand, like probably by the time I finish, he'll be waiting 2.5-3 years or something. And he's kind of getting skipped up a little bit over like,
but he could get it, turn around and sell it for double easy.
He probably could. This guy's like a fanatic. He goes fishing. Yeah. Like he takes, I mean, he's in Northern California, I believe, but he goes to like Alaska and stuff, like, you know, a couple times a year on guided trips and stuff like that. And,
I'm going to assume that you're never happy with your work. Is that a fair assumption?
I get satisfied.
Okay.
Until it's finished. And then I get satisfied.
Like, I wish I would have done it like this, or I wish I would have done that.
For instance, the butterfly, I've been on it since New Year's. Like I've fit in like this fish. I put a couple weeks into this fish and I did a couple small little things in between just to kind of pay the bills. Cause I've been putting so much extra time into this big, it's called a malachite butterfly with a 40-inch wingspan. I wanted to take it to the next level. The two that I did prior were, I'd say a 25-inch wingspan with the wings up and a 35-inch wingspan with the wings out. And to me, I after doing those two, and those were the best two I'd ever done, and it was about $7,500, it would have been worth more probably the amount of time I put into it, but that's what I charged for those two. So the guy that came to me said, like, what could you do for a little bit more? I said, like, let's go 4 grand, and I'll just go with it. So I took it to the next level, and I had to be satisfied, like you were saying. I have to like look at what I've done and then up it. Like I'm not happy unless I up it. Unless I could take something that like I didn't like about the last one.
Yeah.
And sometimes it's hard at first to find what I don't like about it because you put so many hours into it. But then like after staring at it for a minute, and that's why sometimes I won't even touch it for 3 days. I'll work on something else.
Yeah.
Like if I get to the point where I'm like, I can't figure out how to make this better than it is, but I know that I want it to be better. I just don't know what that is. I'll have to take my eyes off it, my head out of it. Sometimes I might spend a whole day just searching the internet, looking at Instagram, looking at guides, you know, like your pose and all these other fishing guides. I follow like probably 1,000 different fishing guides. And like, I just go down and I just look under the hashtags under trout or whatever I'm working on. Like, and I might find that one picture that somebody posted. It'll inspire me to like, it might look slightly different than what I've been working on. It's the same thing, same subject, might be the same butterfly, the same fish, whatever, but it's that angle, the color of it, maybe the kite on the bottom, you know, the mouth is slightly different, and something inspires me. And I'm like, that's what I need on this project. And then I'll go back to it. And then like, I'll start working on it. But I'll lose the inspiration because I don't know where I need to take it.
Yeah. When you get to that point where you're kind of done, but you're not done and you're still open to making refinements, have you painted it at that point? Is it like pretty much it could be thrown in a box and shipped?
The one I'm at right now, I've been working on it actually. I started on it before Christmas and then I put it aside to finish Christmas, like Christmas rush type small stuff. And then I decided to totally 100% committed to that, the one I've been working on right after New Year's. And I've been on it every single day since, except other than a couple small projects to fit in. And the guy's not in a rush, but I finally got it done, finished painted, and I was going to clear coat it. Which clear coat is basically, you know, like a car, like you get done doing all the paint.
It's a final step pretty much.
Yeah. And you guys, I guess, have seen that malachite, the big one. I posted pictures of it finished painted and stuff. Mm-hmm. So now I'm like, it's been 2-3 days and I was going to clear coat it like immediately. And then like, I know I go, there's gotta be something that I'm missing. And I just didn't want to clear coat it and think like, why didn't I do that? So I just set it aside like 2-3 days ago when I finished painting it. And immediately last night, I didn't touch it all day yesterday. I actually spent the whole day just like looking at pictures of them. And I found different pictures of them from different parts of the world, the same exact butterfly from different parts. And the coloration and the veins were slightly different. And I'm like, okay, how I did those veins, that right there can make a little, that'll make the difference. I'll be satisfied now. And so that's what I'm going to do when I get home tonight. I'm going to tear it all back apart because I made it to where the wings bolt together inside the body. Mm-hmm. I'm going to tear it all back apart and I'm going to like tape mask off like all the veins like in the lower wings. And then I'm going to like go in and there's like a technique that I learned on the body that I can for just experimenting. That I'm going to do that same technique where it kind of has that rusted color, but then you see the white kind of coming through it and it almost looks like fur kind of in a way. Wow. I'm going to do that on those veins through the greens and the blues. And then like on each side of the veins, you'll have like a little white highlight. It's like some crazy amount of masking and taping and fine detail. And they're talking about the veins that are only this big, but it's going to have all these layers of colors and variations in them. But I think that would be the point right there where I'll be like, finally, like, okay, I'm going to clear coat it before I come up with another idea.
Yeah. I think there's a lot of fly tires that are, you know, very competent tires that are probably getting a lot of insight from you right now. And I appreciate you we're going to wrap this up now, I think, for real, but I could talk to you for another 5 hours probably, but Nick's got to go and I got to feed little my guy. Dog. So, well, once again, one more time with the Instagrams, Steven Nielsen Art.
Yeah. It's Steve Nielsen Art. And then, under Facebook, it's Steve Nielsen Artist.
Very cool. Sweet. And check him out on Etsy. Thanks for listening to this episode. It was not the one you guys are normally used to, but we hope you enjoyed it. We really liked having you on the show, and it was a privilege to have you here today.
I appreciate it.
Let's go fish soon, man.
Yeah, for sure.
All right. Tight lines, everybody. Yeah.
Johnny, can we shut it down now? All right.
Cameras are dead.
This podcast would not be possible without support from our sponsors, FishBio and Amped.Build. FishBio is a consulting firm that offers a fresh approach to fishery science. They specialize in fish research, monitoring, and conservation with innovative uses of technology and communication. From their offices in Chico, Oakdale, and Santa Cruz, California, to Vientiane, Laos, FishBio is committed to solving natural resource challenges locally and globally. Learn more at www.fishbio.com. And Amped.Build. Amped is a software design and engineering shop located in Chico, California. Amped creates beautiful apps for mobile and desktop devices, wearables, and the Internet of Things. Amped develops native, web, and hybrid apps on a variety of platforms. Chad, who co-hosts this podcast, is the agency's founder. Learn more at www.amped.build.